Welcome back to the Modern Old School Training Podcast. I'm Aaron King with Coach Bob King, as usual. And today's topic is something that came up on YouTube. And so keep bringing those questions if you have questions. Just put them in the comments below. Make sure you click like and subscribe on this video if you like it. There'll be more content coming. But today's topic is the difference between straightaway track sprinting and speed for sport. So just not just the breakaway, because there's still that element of breaking away on a, you know, 40-50 yard play in football, right, or whether it's rugby or soccer, but the difference between just pure best practices in track mechanics and what you look for in sports, with, because you have quickness, you have agility and all the different things, defense, and there, you know, you're always moving around, so it's a very different thing you're looking for, right, when you're coaching it. So off the bat, I mean, kind of, how do you want to jump it off?
Just that's a great way to segue, is because we train everybody to be a sprinter. You pick a sport, yes, we train you to be a sprinter. But what we also have to understand is that in track and field, you're running from A to B. Now, all you do, and I don't mean it to, disrespect it, it just is that what you do is you come off the line and you get as fast as you can to the finish line. And then when you get to the finish line, you have all the room you need to slow down and decelerate. Sports doesn't let you do that.
Right.
You have to, when I was working with MLS, Dallas Burns Soccer Club, we talked to our players that there are four speeds in soccer. You sprint, jog, walk, and then when you get into the second half, you start doing a fast walk and less jogging because of the fatigue situation. And the point being this, you may be jogging down a field of competition and the play changes, you got to hit the gas right then, and it abruptly, whether it's a fast break, a counter, whatever it is, you have to hit the brakes and go back the other way and hit the brakes hard and make a play. And so your body is in multiple positions and multiple planes, and you have to be able to do a lot of things at once, as opposed to track and field, where you have to, be able to go A to B as fast as possible.
You lose best practices. I mean, it's the irregularity. So that was a good point about, you get to slow down and all those things. Mm-hmm. So addressing something that you hear a lot, the drive phase, in track, and say it's 100 meters.
Mm-hmm.
Those are usually your fastest guys. They have this drive phase. You might see a guy out the blocks doing great, but then here comes Usain Bolt or whoever it is, in that last 40 yards, and just the afterburners turn on. So you lose that, when I have to turn around on defense and get back.
Yes.
Or I have to run down a ball. So what? Where do you – why is there less – why do we focus on certain things in track and field? Let's talk about that a little bit, because, you hear a lot about the drive phase and all those things. What's that focus?
The thing about that is let's stay with 100 meters. And the reason for that is that's what everybody uses as a standard for their 60 in baseball, 40 in football, and so forth. What you want to keep in mind is that when you said the last 40 yards or 40 meters, if you subtract that to 100, that's 60. Well, that means football's done, baseball's finishing, and track and field, or the 100 meters, is just getting going. And so that's the difference. You have room. In the other sports, you don't have room. Now, to tag along what I said a minute ago about training everybody to be a sprinter, we tell them, we're going to train you how to be a sprinter with the best speed mechanics possible. Then when you get back onto your court or field, your sports posture will take over. And so we don't blur the lines. We keep them very, very separated. We're teaching you how to be a sprinter. So that first step, that acceleration, that burst off the line or whatever it is there. Then we also teach about sports posture. What you do in practice every day is going to be in effect and take over when it's time to make a play on the opponent or respond to a reaction in the game.
That's good stuff. I remember back in college, we had a couple of athletes that were really great. We had Johnny Lee Higgins, was a football player.
Right.
And then we had Sherandy Martina, was one of the fastest men in the world at the time. Mm-hmm. He was at UTEP. These are all UTEP athletes. We were loaded at the time. And Sherandy, I think he ran for out of Netherlands. And in London, he finished, I believe, in second place behind Usain Bolt in the 200 meters. But he was disqualified because he stepped on the line or something.
Yeah.
But that's fast.
That's fast. That's fast anywhere in the world.
Johnny Lee was also, he was one of those, he's all pro, all NFL for the Raiders, punt returner, had like three weeks in a row with a touchdown in the NFL or something like that. They ran track together at UTEP. Mm-hmm. And Johnny did it. Some of the football guys would run track, but then you have Olympic level guys like Sherandy. he was Johnny came out of the blocks and was winning that. He was that 40 yards.
Yeah.
Johnny was the man. Sharandy, it was no competition after that. I mean, right. Johnny, don't get me wrong. Johnny's fast.
He saw him run.
It's crazy to see, how that translates from sport to sport.
It really does.
What are some other sports though? That soccer. So what can I expect from speed? Like if I have the fastest soccer players in the world,
let me throw this out to people is that I think that there is a subconscious, I don't know what you call it, mechanism in the athlete's brain because we kind of did a little breakdown in the study. We figured now basketball is a 94-foot court. Mm-hmm. I calculated that you have 55 feet of that to be able to sprint. If you inbound the ball, you have 55 feet where you can just take off and go and sprint if you want to sprint before you have to get into sports posture.
Right.
You know that automatically. You know you're not sprinting indefinitely. Tennis, you might have 7 yards. Baseball, you have further, but the bases are 90 feet, but you're gonna make a turn. So you know you're gonna slow down. Those things are built into an athlete's mentality, and I think that's a big difference between the track guy who knows from the beginning, I'm going from A to B, and I'm going to build it up like this.
And run through the finish line.
And if I run 100 meters, I may slow down at the 175-meter mark. Whereas that football player, even if he takes the ball out of the end zone, he's still only going to run 170 yards max. I mean, he's not going to run 200 or anything. So there's limitations, I think, the athlete of field sport, court sports already have built in.
So what is that? Let's talk a little bit about the transition into the training side. So if I know I'm a tennis player, that I'm never going to run more than, however many yards you said it was. I'm never going to run that far, so why would I work on high speed? Or if I'm an offensive lineman, I'm never going more than 10 yards.
Let me tell you something. You're asking me a question that I had objected to years ago. Somebody go, why I got to do this?
Just for the record, I'm playing devil's advocate, and I'm trying to get the answers to the questions that we always hear.
This is something that comes up a lot. I'm going to go to tennis because I was actually speaking at a tennis clinic of tennis pros, and I was starting to talk about our training will run out from 0 to 30. And I had a tennis instructor go, we don't run 30 yards. Mm-hmm. And I say, okay, let's go back. Now track and field crosses over. You have the start and the drive phase, then you have the acceleration. So if I want to, okay, here we go. If I'm in the weight room, I put weight on the bar because sprint strides are like weight room reps.
Right.
You rep the bar to get stronger, so you have to sprint to get faster. You're not faster until you get out there for some of these athletes, 15, 20 yards, and you're going. So if we just run 10 and 15 yards, then that's your cap. But if we can get you past 15 yards, we know you're up and running at a possible full speed for you. Now your body knows how to go fast.
Right.
And the other side of it, we do limit the distances that the shorter athlete distances have to go. But we also know that there's a tremendous conditioning factor, like in our high-speed 110 program. 110 yards or 100 meters at high speed, you are turning it over, and that's how you get faster. You have to get out to that speed zone, if you want to call it that.
Kind of works almost as over speed for that athlete that doesn't go that far. And so I'm going to touch on that, the point you made about the weight room reps. Because we've talked about that before with overtraining, change direction, some of those things. You have to factor that into your training. Yeah, and so one of the reasons in the previous podcast, we talked about why speed, why it's challenging, why we focus on it. Mm-hmm. But what does it do for just strength too? So if I can run 30 yards to be fast in a shorter distance, now what is it doing for also just that strength, that the ability to stop and start again, not just change direction, but high speed and change of direction.
Now the decelerating aspect is huge because as you run faster, it takes more strength to apply force to stop. And if you run faster, you're applying more ground force and tear away to get to those speed reps, as I call it, on the track running, sprint strides. And so strength is inseparable to the equation. Mm-hmm. And so especially for field court, any athlete who has to stop and change direction, it takes a tremendous amount of strength to hit the brakes. When we say that phrase, the amount of strength it takes to hit the brakes and then to come back a different direction is even if it's just a slight turn, you still are applying tremendous force to the ground to be able to get your body in that momentum to go in a different direction. Strength is just inseparable to the equation.
This is kind of a tangent, but it just reminded me of a story. I remember when I was training for the U.S. bobsled team, I had the hardest time replicating what it was to, without a bobsled push track, to replicate actually running downhill. Because yeah. when you're running downhill with a bobsled, you jump into the bobsled. Mm-hmm. That's your deceleration.
Yes.
But when you run downhill, it's really hard to stop.
It's hard to stop.
And so that yes. was one of the probably the biggest challenges I ever had in uh-huh. like saying, okay, I'm a rookie. How the heck am I going to simulate running downhill without being able to do it?
Yeah.
And then a lot what was so impressive, and it took me a while to catch on, or not catch on, but adjust.
Right.
We'd hit that bobsled's 500-600 pounds.
Yes.
When you hit that, that's a full max hang clean is yeah. basically what you're doing.
Sure it is.
We'd go straight to the weight room and do hang cleans, power uh-huh. cleans. I was so weak compared to what I thought I was. I mean, I was strong, but when I went in the weight room and watched those guys throw on weight after we just hit the sleds,
uh-huh.
I mean, it took me a while to adjust. But it's just funny when you think about training for your sport,
mm-hmm.
it's hard to replicate certain things.
It is. And what you have to do is you have to build in as much, and this is just now we're getting to Bob King's opinion, but you have to just build in as much raw strength as you can mm-hmm. because you may lose part of that with the mechanics of your individual sport, but you have that to draw upon. And if you have a strong base of strength or a big base of strength, then you can start channeling it and harness that into the direction it needs to be applied.
So my favorite thing for just that helped me is the hills.
Mm-hmm.
Steep hill. Yeah. I mean, probably the hill I would run was about 35 yards, but it was very steep.
Right.
Is there a sport that doesn't work with? Or doesn't everyone benefit?
Man, I don't think anybody doesn't benefit from that. And we discovered this. There were some innovators in the, I lost track of time, 88, 92, in that four-year scheme where one of the Spinks brothers was trained by a guy who said, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to go out and run 800s.
Mm-hmm.
That's going to be about the length of a time of a round. Boxers didn't do that at that time.
Right.
And so where I'm headed with this, the phrase cross-training, I don't know where it started, but what it means is I'm doing something that my sport really doesn't normally do. That's good for the body.
Right.
That is good. We already mentioned the high-speed 110s. Cross the board. It just makes your system, your body, know how to be explosive and fast on the money, right on the mark. And so crossing over into other areas can be very beneficial. And some of the greatest athletes, when I was back at the Dallas Mavericks and I'd call colleges about draft prospects, we had a guy, and I forget his name, excuse me for that, but he was up in the Northeast in Maine or Massachusetts or something. And I talked to them up there. He ran the 400 hurdles in high school. He played college. I mean, he played soccer. And he was a star basketball player. We were looking at it for the draft. I went to the front office and said, get this guy if he's available because I know he can run. Period. And sure enough, I was right. We didn't get him because everybody else knew what we knew. And man, he was a stud. So that crossing over can be extremely beneficial.
The NBA's got to have some of the best athletes in the world. Those guys are freaks. I mean, if I could be any athlete, I think I would love to say I'm an NBA basketball player just because you're going against probably the best athletes in the world.
Well, I've seen
size,
them
speed, everything.
I've seen them in the off season, and they come in and they do whatever they want. I mean, we had our two starting guards were tennis fanatics. I mean, they would go and play competitive tennis, not just hit around in the backyard. But they could do anything they wanted.
All right, that's all the time we have today. We're going to talk more and more about the speed for sport. If you have questions, as I mentioned, put them in the comments below. This is obviously if you're on our YouTube channel. Hit us up on Twitter. I'm at Deep Snap. Coach Bob King is at Coach Bob King. Any questions you have, we'll answer them. I think next time a good topic, because you kind of touched on it, about fighting. Because we have a lot of fighters, UFC fighters, mm-hmm. Muay Thai, just a lot of different fighters that are doing our training around the world. And, you know, especially with mixed martial arts coming up, there's a lot of application that you can get.
Absolutely.
And don't get me wrong. I mean, there's no replacement for that type of training they do, because that's mm-hmm. a whole other world. But you can benefit from just speed and agility training.
Footwork.
Yeah, footwork, and then that endurance that you can do with the longer stuff like we talked about. So I think that's all we got for today. If you got anything, hit us up below. Look forward to talking to you next time.